لا
الحمد لله رب العالمين، نحمده ونستعين به ونستغفره ونستهديه، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله، بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح لهذه الأمة، فتركها عن المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، وارض اللهم عن سادتنا أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وعن الصحابة وتابعيهم وتابعيهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, this is the last Jum'ah of Ramadan. I ask Allah Almighty to accept our efforts, our humble, very humble efforts of this month. I will give you a short example. Imam al-Ghazali, he said, imagine that the king has invited all of the dignitaries to his palace, and they have to bring with them gifts, money, expensive jewelry, all sorts of presents. That day, the farmer, picked up a basket of vegetables and went to the palace and pushed his way through the people, those rich and famous and high dignitaries who were at the king's event and who gave the king a very expensive gift. He pushed his way through with a basket of vegetables. The farmer dressed up in his farming clothes, smelly clothes, vegetables, and he pushed his way through them all the way to the king. And he gave it to the king and told him, this is my gift to you. Surprisingly enough, the response of the king was very, very, very generous. He gave him a garment that was a very, very expensive gift compared to what everybody got. Now, as the farmer was sitting next to the king, who was very generous to him, he started telling the king how the king was fortunate to have the farmer's gift among the other gifts, and how the farmer was humble enough to come and visit the king. In other words, he was making the king, he was making himself that he had given his best to the king, and he is showing the king that the king needs him more than he needs the king. يعني in Arabic, يمن عليه. He gives him the gift and he tells him, I am the farmer, you know, I'm being very humble to you that I gave you this gift. And I think you, Mr. King, you are very lucky to have someone like me to talk to you. Otherwise, I don't have time for someone like you. And I think, I'm very humble myself. I gave you this gift and very humble that I managed to, you know, I had some enough time. That type of behavior. Imam al-Ghazali says, when you think of someone mistreatment to someone who is humble to him, you would either think of one thing. Either the farmer was crazy, or the farmer has misbehaved. Now, listen what Imam Ghazali says. based on the situation. He said, now, remember you have prayed the night and you have been fasting and you have fulfilled your worship requirements towards Allah. Once you finish these prayers, remember that you are not doing Allah a favor. You are not the only one that night who prayed to Allah. You are among the millions and billions of Muslims worldwide. So if you think the few raka'at, the few fasting days you did Allah a favor, there are millions and millions of Muslims around the world who have superseded the quality of the prayer that you have presented to your Creator, and you think you have done a favor to your Creator. Think about it. Your heart might not be aware as you were praying. Think about it. Your intentions were not as pure as others who were in the rest of the world. Your body is not clean as their bodies compared to others who are at that day and at that night challenging you, and they are ahead of you in seeking Allah's mercy. The door of Allah's mercy was being knocked by billions and billions of Muslims seeking the mercy of Allah. And yet, you think you've done Allah a favor for praying a few nights? And then he said, Imam al-Ghazali, to this example, فَانْظُرْ أَيُّهَا الْعَاقِلِ. Look carefully at the example that I told you, with a proper mindset. Did you present your prayers to the King of the universe the way you present a gift to the King who is on earth, and who are these high dignitaries, the way they present their presents? That is why, based on that teachings, Imam Shafi'i has said a very good sentence. He said, as you perform your prayers and your duties towards Allah, remember three things. Remember whom you want to please. Second thing, remember what type of pleasure you seek to get. And remember what type of punishment you want to escape from. فَذْكُرْ رِضَى مَنْ تَطْلُبْ وَفِي أَيِّ نَعِيمٍ تَرْغَبْ وَفِي أَيِّ عِقَابٍ تَرْهَبْ. These three elements puts you back to the size that you should be in. You should not think what you have done from efforts that you are doing Allah a favor. Allah's favors are far beyond what you give. Allah is generous. He gave you more and more and more than what you have given. Therefore, know how much your size is and be humble in asking Allah to accept your deeds that you have given. Ruya an Ali radiallahu anhu. Ali ibn Abi Talib is the companion of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. See what his behavior happens. And that dictates what I've just mentioned. He used to call on the last night of Ramadan. He used to call upon around him. He said, I wish I'm able to know whom Allah has accepted his deeds and prayers and fasting in Ramadan, so I would go and congratulate him. I wish I am able to know whom Allah has rejected, so I'll go to him and give him my condolences. This is Ali ibn Abi Talib. And you know the value of Ali ibn Abi Talib. He is worried. He does not know anything about where his deeds are. He wants to know if someone is able to know that Allah has accepted his deeds in the last night of Ramadan, or someone has Allah has rejected. The same principle followed by Abdullah ibn Abbas, also another companion of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said almost the same statement In fact, almost the same statement. He said, who is the one who knows he is accepted? So I'll go and congratulate him. And who knows? And who is the one who is rejected? So I'll go and give him my condolences. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, the fifth Khalifa of Islam, on the day of Eid, he stood up in his khutbah and he said to the people, all you people, you've been fasting for 30 days and you're praying the night for 30 nights. And now, today, you are asking Allah on the day of Eid to accept your efforts. There is nothing, take it for granted. There is nothing, you're not doing a favor to Allah. The sense of fear that what you've done is rejected, and the sense of hope that you ask Allah to accept what you have done, should remain with you during and after Ramadan. That is the sense of what we learned from the companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is the thing that Umar bin Abdul Aziz, the first Khalifa in Islam, stated it purely on the day of Eid. You have come today asking Allah to accept from you. Do you know that Allah has accepted? Do you know that Allah has rejected? You have to live with these two wings of hope of His acceptance and fear of rejection. كان بعض السلف يظهر عليه الحزن يوم العيد. Also the generations of Muslims after the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, on the day of Eid, they showed signs of sadness. And when they were told, this is Eid, you should be joyful, you should be happy, he said, I know it's a day of joy and happiness. And you're right, totally right about that. But I am a slave. And my master has commanded me to do a certain task. And I don't know whether that task is accepted or rejected. أقول ما تسمعون وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان ليوم الدين. This explains why some people fail after Ramadan. The sense that they have done, or they've done Allah a favor in performing what Allah required from them. That's why you see a sharp drop of some people's behavior after 30 days of full discipline in Ramadan. After Ramadan, the whole thing drops. Now, there are 5 or 6 factors that each one of us has to perform in order to maintain your level. And by the way, this explains why the companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, 6 months after Ramadan, they asked Allah to accept their deeds. They've been begging Allah 6 months. And after these 6 months, another 6 months, they asked Allah to let them live the Ramadan that is coming by. These factors are very simple. I'm going to share with you today in order to avoid falling back or slipping the level that we've performed in the month of Ramadan. Because Ramadan is supposed to help elevate your spiritual sense and you build upon it. You don't waste it. You need Allah. Allah does not need you. You live with the hope and fear. The first aspect is the prayers. In Jama'ah, the 5 prayers, especially Salat al-Fajr. For 1 month you've been praying Salat al-Fajr in Jama'ah in the mosque. That you should maintain after the month of Ramadan. 2, the Qur'an. Reading the Qur'an. Qur'an should not go back to the shelf and collect dust till next Ramadan. On daily basis you should have your share of the Qur'an. As minimum as 1 page a day. Let your eyes feast on the look of Ramadan. The discipline of 30 months does not go in a haphazard way. At least 1 page a day. 3, Dhikr Allah. the prayers that you've learned during Ramadan, the supplications, Adhkar al-Sabah, the morning prayers, Adhkar al-Sabah, the morning supplications, Adhkar al-Masa'. Adhkar al-Sabah protects you throughout the day. Adhkar al-Masa' protects you throughout the night. Learn to read them. Have them in your car. Listen to them. You start memorizing them. They are part of your daily, if my expression is right, breakfast and dinner. Also the other adhkar, what you say as you leave your home, what you say as you ride in your car, what you say as you have your food, what you say as you go to sleep. You don't have to memorize them. Put them in cards, put them to where you are and read them. Slowly you start memorizing them. This is part of the discipline that we learned in the month of Ramadan. 4. What group are you with? Your companions, your friends, are they in the same spiritual level as you are? Are they higher than you or are they lower than you? That support group is very important. You have to seek friendship with people who are better than you in their faith in order for yourself to keep up your pace with them. 5. I remind you of عن سلمان الفارسي رضي الله عنه. He said that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam narrates about Allah Almighty. Allah says, I am with my worshipper when he thinks of me, and I am with him when he asks me. Allah is with you all the time. You only have to ask Allah. You only have to ask Allah. Allah is with you. What is holding you back from seeking the help of Ramadan? Of Allah. Ramadan is not a switch of on and off. Ramadan is supposed to take you throughout your lifetime. And guess what? Ramadan is coming next year. No one knows who's going to be living here next year. As in dua, remember the same way in the month of Ramadan you've been calling upon Allah in the nightly hours, asking Allah for help. The creator of the universe whom you have worshipped in the month of Ramadan, Allah is not only in Ramadan. Allah is with you throughout the year. So you have to keep praying and supplication and asking Allah. Therefore, assign yourself at least 2 minutes. 2 minutes. 1 minute. As you come to the masjid to pray, after you pray, raise your hands and ask Allah. Anything. But teach yourself this discipline of asking Allah. Don't be like the farmer who brought in some cheap gifts expecting to be better, and he thought that he was doing the king a favor. Had it been the king was polite enough and generous enough, he could have kicked him out of the palace. Qiyam al-Layl, the night prayer. The night prayer is not only in Ramadan. The night prayer should be with you throughout the year. Assign yourself one day of the week. One day of the week. Pray a few rak'ahs and ask Allah. This will help you maintain your Ramadan spirit. Your self-education about Islamic knowledge. The Jum'ah khutbah is here to remind you. It's not here to teach you. As we are keen on learning, we should be keen on learning about our religion. Alhamdulillah, the books of Islamic books and the websites are filled with information. You should have time to read. You should read about your religion. Don't wait for the khutbah to teach you. It will not teach you. It will only remind you. If we are serious about a religion, we have to read about it and learn and educate ourselves about Islam. Also fasting. I remind you what the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ used to fast Mondays and Thursdays. Pick one day. Monday or Thursday. Or one day every week or 2 weeks. But keep the discipline going. Whatever you choose, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, from the points I have mentioned, these will make sure that you can change your life. Ramadan puts you in the mood of changing your life to the better and not going back to the worse. I ask Allah Almighty, as this is, we are counting the last few breaths that we have in this month of Ramadan, that Allah would accept our deeds, and Allah would accept our fasting, and Allah would accept our efforts, and Allah would spare us from hellfire, us and our families and our loved ones, and those whom we have prayed for, and our deceased and everybody. Allahumma aghfir lil mu'minin wal mu'minat, al muslimin wal muslimat, al ahya'i minhum wal amwat, innaka sami'un mujib al da'awat. Allahumma a'tiq riqabana, Allahumma a'tiq riqabana, Allahumma a'tiq riqabana fi hadha ash-shahr al-fadil. Allahumma aj'alna min al-maqbulin fi hadha ash-shahr al-fadil. اللهم اجعلنا من المقبولين. اللهم تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم، وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. اللهم نسألك الجنة وما قرب إليها من قول وعمل، ونعوذ بك من النار وما قرب إليها من قول وعمل. اللهم نسألك الفردوس الأعلى، ونسألك لذة النظر إلى وجهك الكريم والشوق إلى لقائك من غير ضراء مضرة ولا فتنة مضلة، واجمعنا بالمصطفى صلى الله عليه وسلم نشرب من يده الشريفة شربة لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا. اللهم زين القرآن في قلوبنا، وأعنا على الصيام والقيام وقراءة القرآن، وعلمنا من دينك يا رب العالمين. اللهم ارحم موتانا وموتى المسلمين، اللهم ارحمنا إذا سرنا إلى ما ساروا إليه، اللهم اغفر لنا ولوالدينا ومن له حق علينا، وأصلح ذرياتنا ومن حولنا يا رب العالمين. اللهم تقبل أعمالنا، اللهم لا تجعلها هباء منثورا. اللهم إنا نسألك من خير ما سألك عبدك ونبيك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم والصحابة والتابعين في هذا اليوم الجليل، من هذا الشهر الجليل، من هذه اللحظة والساعات الأخيرة من شهر رمضان المبارك. اللهم بلغنا من دعائهم، وبلغنا ما سألوك، واجمعنا معهم بالفردوس الأعلى. عباد الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون، وأقم الصلاة.